so that we don't get even further behind at this early stage, so that you won't still be here at 8 tonight, we ought to get started. At least two of the three speakers are a distinguished panel. We have Dr. Basri, who is arguably the best economist in Indonesia, and also, of course, has held many high government positions, including Minister of Finance. It would be nice if we always had really high qualified economists as ministers of finance. And we have Professor Popinski from Cornell, who represents the younger generation of Indonesia specialists. Everybody in this room, with the exception of Gus and David Cole, is part of the younger generation, as far as I'm concerned. And then you have me. I'm an emeritus professor at Harvard, and have spent a lot of time traveling to Southeast Asia, but I don't qualify as an Indonesian specialist. So we're going to start with Dr. Basri, and then Professor Popinski, and then I will say a few comparative things. So, Dr. Basri.
Thank you very much, Dwight. A very good morning to all of you. It is a great pleasure to be here. This morning, I would like to discuss about the economic growth, and the title of my presentation is "Did Indonesia Push It Luck Too Far?" So let me start with the questions to be addressed. There are three things that I would like to discuss this morning. The first one is, what are the lessons learned of the economic growth in Indonesia after the Asian financial crisis? The second one is, what are the challenges in the future? And then, will Indonesia be able to shift into the high gear? That will be the three questions that I would like to address. But before I discuss about the lesson learned about the growth story in Indonesia, let me start with the one statement. If I have to describe Indonesia, I would say that Indonesia is a disappointing country, because it disappoints the optimists. You know, many people who expect that Indonesia can grow by more than 10%. But it also disappoints the pessimists, who keep making an analysis every day that this country will collapse. So we are always in this, you know. And then, so let me start to see about the, well, this is a busy chart. Don't worry too much. I promise to speak in the human language. The problem with the economists, Dwight, they always like to talk in a language that nobody understands. And the more people confuse, the better they are as an economist. So basically, these two charts says that if we look at Indonesia in comparative perspective, we are not too bad, actually. Because if you're talking about China, about 6.8% now, India 7.5%, Indonesia is still three fastest growing economy among the G20 members. If you compare with the resources producers like Brazil, like South Africa, even Australia, you know, many countries would love to have this 4.7% economic growth nowadays. So basically, relatively speaking, we are not too bad. And if you compare with Philippines and Vietnam, of course, those two countries, they grew faster than us. But don't forget, Philippines and Vietnam, they are not a resource producer. So if you look at from this perspective, basically, the performance in Indonesia is not too bad, but definitely is not enough. Because if we want to handle the issue of poverty, you know, by creating jobs, we need to grow by more than 7%. So this is not enough. And this is the Indonesia's balance sheet, actually. On the asset side, we have this macroeconomic stability. Indonesia has been known for the good macroeconomic stability since the new order government. The demographic dividend, strong consumption, relatively high GDP growth, as I mentioned to you earlier. The political stability, if you look at in terms of the political stability, I believe that my colleague from the, you know, the political scientists will discuss about it. But there are some liabilities, like the poor quality of infrastructure, human resources, low productivity, declining competitiveness of manufacturing, inequality, financing, and investment climate. We'll discuss about it later on. But this is basically the balance sheet. Yeah, we do have the potential, but we do have the liability. So the first question is, what were the source of growth? If you look at from these charts, it shows that on the right-hand side, It shows that our source of growth in Indonesia were basically driven by private consumption and investment. And private consumption is taken, probably accounted for about almost 60% of our GDP. And if you look at the investment story was very interesting, that investment became the source of growth, especially after the 2009. Why was that? The reason behind it was because the quantitative easing. I was the chairman of the investment board. Probably I would consider I was quite successful, not because I was good, but because I was lucky. Why? Because the US announced the quantitative easing policy at that time, which is drove the capital outflows into emerging markets, including Indonesia, and pushed the commodity price, you know, to the very relatively high level. So Indonesia benefited by those of two. So basically, the Indonesian story in the 2008 to 2014 was basically Latin American story. Look at this. The song remains the same. This is the title song from the Led Zeppelin, if you like the rock music. Yeah, commodities and investment boom. Yeah, if you look at on the green dot line, it shows that the commodity price went up after the U.S. launched the quantitative easing. And if you look at about the emerging private capital, similar to the investment went up significantly because the capital inflow into Indonesia. So it's quite consistent. And this story happened in the Latin America in the 1990s, when US had a relatively low interest rate and pushed the capital into Latin America. They got a problem of the real appreciation of the exchange rate, got a problem of the current account deficit. Look at this. But unfortunately, most of the capital that went into Indonesia, they focused on domestic market. What are the sectors? Automotive, pharmaceutical, food, machinery, with this we don't really much export machinery except electronics, and natural resources. Of course, I do understand that probably at that time, the government of Bank Indonesia should somehow intervene the forex market by not letting the exchange rate appreciate too much. But how could Bank Indonesia do it? Because the amount that capital inflow that came to Indonesia in since 2009 to 2013, we are talking about $60 billion. There is no way that our reserve could do a sterilization, because the sterilization will be very expensive. And if you look at this portfolio and then FDI, dominated by the FDI up to 2012, but 2013 dominated by the portfolio. So this end up with this in a similar chart. Look at this. This is the relation between the current account deficit and the private capital inflows. So when there was a capital inflow, current account become deficit. Why? Because we had the real appreciation of the exchange rate, reduce export, and induce import. So our competitiveness declined because of this capital inflow and the commodity boom. So basically, what I was trying to say, Indonesia had a mild Dutch disease. So logically, what we had to do, we have to let the exchange rate to depreciate, or we should tighten the fiscal. But politically, it's very difficult that you have to tighten the fiscal during the economic boom. It is politically, it's very difficult. We discuss about it later on. So there's something wrong about the Indonesian recent growth model. Why? Because the current account continued to become deficit, even the non-oil manufacturing sector. And the reason behind is because we suffered from the so-called Dutch disease. So the story of the Indonesian growth post of the Asian financial crisis, we suffered from the Dutch disease because the real appreciation of the exchange rate, and also got a problem of the high-cost economy. And because of this current account deficit problem, so we had to manage the taper tantrum. So the government and the Bank Indonesia, you know, deliberately has to slow down the growth in order to handle the issue of this current account deficit. And this is basically really a textbook case situation. Yeah, I was very happy. I wouldn't say very happy, because when I learned this story, I consulted to the textbook. Oh, this is really the balance of, you know, the balance of payment problem. So what we did at the time is we cut the expenditure. By expenditure reducing policy, we cut the fuel subsidy, we raised the interest rate, and let the exchange rate to depreciate. And here is the econometrics result of the test. I just knew it, that our policy consistent with the theory, after I did the econometrics result recently, about 2 weeks ago. When we did that, I didn't do the econometrics test. I just received this result about three weeks ago. Basically, it shows that the exchange rate will improve the trade balance. Raising the interest rate, the BI rate will improve the trade balance. And having this budget surplus of cutting the fuel subsidy will improve the trade balance. You know, if anyone interested about these technical things, we'll discuss, can discuss later on. So lesson learned from the post-Asian financial crisis is declining competitiveness. Look at this. The sector, the structure of the economy shift into natural resources. But the manufacturing steadily declined. Look at on the chart on the right-hand side. And the concentration of the manufacturing of Indonesian export is highly concentrated on the natural resources. And this is very typical of the Dutch disease. The employment growth increase in mining and construction, the tradable sector. And look at the real wages, increase on mining and construction. The solution of it was quite clear. We should depreciate the exchange rate. But we are only able to depreciate the exchange rate in 2013. Yeah, not because at the time I took a job as a Minister of Finance, but because the pressure due to the taper tantrum. Yeah, but we started to depreciate the exchange rate in 2013. In fact, we are supposed to do it probably in the mid-2009. Then, what should I tell about this story? Indonesia focused on the domestic economy. But if you look at on this number, you see that the major source of growth for the Asian economy is basically export. But we dump it. We focus on the domestic economy. So this is the mistake that probably we made at the time. What are the lessons learned? I mentioned to you, we probably have to raise the interest rate. Bank Indonesia should raise the interest rate early on. The government should cut the subsidy perhaps in 2010 instead of 2013. If we did that kind of things, we probably enter the taper tantrum in a better situation. Or we should depreciate the exchange rate much earlier. But the question is, we were not able to do it because how could you handle this capital inflow, $60 billion? How could you depreciate the exchange rate if the pressure is so huge at a time? We were lucky we cut the fuel subsidy in 2013, 2014. Jokowi administration did it. Unfortunately, the subsidy is back now. Yeah, the government not entirely removed the fuel subsidy because the subsidy is back. The government did not adjust the fuel price anymore. So what are the future challenges? I won't discuss about this too much, but three things on the black box. The first one is the slowdown of China. The second one, the possibility of the interest rate hike. And the third one is declining oil price. I would say that the interest rate hike basically is, you know, it's perceived by the market, it's already priced in. But one thing that I'm concerned about is slowdown of China, because nobody knows what is happening in China. We don't really know what the real economic growth now, what about their balance sheet. And if something shock happened in China, it will affect the whole entire emerging economies, including Indonesia. So under this kind of situation, it's not going to be easy. So shifting to high gear, this is the things that we try to do a sort of like, you know, estimate about it. The first chart on the left-hand side shows that if we focus on the medium and high-tech manufacturing, the volatility is relatively small. But on the right-hand side, if we focus on the natural resources, the volatility is relatively high. So if Indonesia continue to stay on natural resources, the volatility of our export will be relatively high, which is very risky because the boom-bust cycle. So Indonesia cannot continue to stay on natural resources. So in the future, we should move into the manufacturing. Look at this. This is the Harpindo Index to show the concentration. I took the story about 80s. With the devaluation, the regulations, and low oil price, it helped Indonesia to diversify its export products. But the concentration index slightly increased recently. Why? Because the Dutch disease story. So if we want to improve this, we probably have to repeat the story in the 80s, which is conducted by the so-called technocrat about the economic devaluation, about the deregulations, and we were lucky now because the commodity price is relatively low. What about our capability to shift into high gear? If you look at from these charts, we improve our capability using this Hausmann index, but unfortunately not much. So Indonesia is not really able to make, to produce things which is quite complicated. So we still have a problem here. So So it shows that our problem, probably one of our biggest problem, is the quality of human resources. If you want to, you know, we cannot continue to rely on natural resources, but if we want to move to the manufacturing, we need to be supported by the strong human capital. And we also need to improve about logistics. There's an improvement about logistics, but it's not enough. So looking at this, probably we're talking about industrial policy. I'm not a big fan of the industrial policy because in our history, in the past, it's always end up with rent-seeking. Yeah. Rent-seeking activities, I keep saying this, government is very bad in picking winner, but losers are very good in picking government, which is true in Indonesia and also many countries in the world. So once you let the government to intervene, it will end up with the issue of the rent-seeking. Yeah, but somehow, there is a role for the government. Perhaps for the R&D, there is a role for the government for the improve the efficient service of the, you know, the services sector to support the manufacturing. And I think also, related to the human capital. I'm a big fan that probably the government should do something on the human capital. We provide a scholarship now, we provide a sort of like funding for the R&D. We probably in the future we need to do that. So looking forward, shifting towards high growth economy cannot happen instantly because in the short term we have to deal with the current account. But if we want to shifting into high gear, investment in human capitals is necessary. And need to be accompanied by a steady investment improvement on the issue of this governance, environment for knowledge exchange, the labor market. The labor market story is a very important one. In 2013 and 2003, we submitted a labor law. I don't know many of you aware about it. One of the issues about the labor law is the severance payment. Indonesia is probably the country with the highest severance payment in the world. If you have to do the downsizing, you have to pay about 24 months, you know, severance payment. It acts like the hiring tax. So nobody would like to absorb the new entrants in the labor market. They prefer to go for the capital intensive. And this explains why the inequality is rising. So with this kind of labor law, it's very difficult, but I don't know, we will see whether the government will revise the labor law. It probably will not easy for Pak Jokowi because this labor law was submitted by Ibu Megawati in 2003. So we will see whether, because definitely we need to do something on this, you know, on the labor law story. And also, of course, the question is, we already know the answer to it, as we discussed, but the question is, do we have chance to implement this policy? It really depends whether the economic situation is continue to be not in the good shape. Because not once the economic situation not in the good shape, like 2013, the technocrat got a chance to launch the reform. But once the economics in the good shape, the politician will ask, why should I jeopardize my political capital if the economic situation is already good? The answer towards that is probably perhaps we should institutionalize reform. So making something that automatic, without being discussed very much with us, you know, in the process of the cabinet meeting, parliament, etc. Otherwise, this process, the answer that we already know, will be truncated by the political process. I think I'll stop it here. Later on, we can discuss in the Q&A. Thank you very much.
So thanks everybody for coming. My name is Tom Papinski and I'm visiting here from Cornell. And before I get started, I want to reflect a little bit on sort of the amazing amount of human capital that we have here in this room. So my brief here is to tell you something about democratization and decentralization in Indonesia for a conference entitled something along the lines of Asia's Inscrutable Giant. If there was ever a room of people who could figure out Indonesia, it's this room right here. So in a sense, my task is to tell you guys things that many of you already know, sort of at least descriptively, and to do it in a way that keeps you interested for 20 minutes. So what I'm going to do is give you sort of the first part of the presentation is going to talk a little bit about some basic descriptive facts for those of you who are not such experts in Indonesia itself, to give you a sort of baseline for understanding the political changes that have happened in Indonesia since 1999. For those of you who are Indonesianists, you can daydream for this part. And then the second half, I'm going to talk a little bit about what I think this means and some things to watch. And so in that second half, I'll try to be a little bit more provocative. I'm going to highlight things that I think are important for us to all reflect upon, those who are experts and those who are not experts. And also, I'm going to give us a chance to talk about a couple things which I think may not be so familiar for many Indonesians and Indonesians themselves, but come out from my position as a foreign scholar of Indonesia. So with that, like, long wind-up, let me get started here. So to understand the changes that have happened in Indonesia in terms of Indonesia's politics since democratization in 1999, I think it's helpful to separate these things into two sets of reforms, two stages of reforms. The first most important set of reforms that happened in Indonesia after the fall of the Suharto regime took place in 1999, when Indonesia held competitive legislative elections. Now, for a political scientist, this is the moment that Indonesia democratized. As soon as there were elections for national office that were competitive and in which the winners of the elections were not foreordained, that is when democratization happened. I'll note here that this was not a direct election for the presidency. I'm going to talk about that in a second, but rather direct elections for the legislature. And the legislature, in combination with some holdovers from the New Order, selected the first president in a democratic election. The second thing that happened in this first stage was a regional autonomy law. This law was passed in 1999, but implemented in 2001. This regional autonomy law, in effect, decentralized decision-making for large amounts of what Indonesian governments had formerly been responsible for, away from the center of Jakarta and towards Indonesia's hundreds of regions. For those of you who are not Indonesianists, the unit that got a policy authority was not the province or the sort of state level thing. It was the district or city. So that would be, in the US context, something akin to a county. And this was important for reasons I'll go into it a little bit later. Okay. Now, the first thing to note is that neither of these things were novel in Indonesia. They were novel in their implementation, not in their procedure. Indonesia had been decentralizing in fits and starts since the Dutch period. Right? So it had always been the case that there was an understanding that a country as large and complex as Indonesia could not be governed simply from Jakarta. And so in various ways this had been implemented. This had been implemented in the 90s under Suharto, in fact. What the 2001 law did was made it a lot more serious. Moreover, elections were not new. Legislative elections in Indonesia were not new. They had been held continuously since 1949, I believe, at least since 1950. And the important thing, reason why I mention this, is because it was not confusing or novel for Indonesians to go to an election or to have an election. The understanding of what elections are was familiar. What was novel about these simply was the fact that the outcome was not foreordained. Okay, and this is the important thing that matters. Now, that's the first stage. The second stage happens in the mid-2000s. The first is the change from a sort of semi-presidential system to a direct presidential system in which the president is elected directly from the population, from the populace. So it's no longer the case that the president is chosen from the legislature. Number two, this is important but not widely remarked upon, was an important clarification of what these decentralization rules actually meant. The rules as implemented, as written in 1999 and as implemented in 2001, were not clear exactly what sort of policy prerogatives went to the districts, what were obligatory functions versus possible functions, what role the provinces had in all of this. And so the 2004 saw an explanation of and sort of a clarification of what these decentralization rules actually were. And these were paired in 2005 by the direct election of district heads. So now, as in national politics, district level politics, is the same way. The executive, the bupati in a non-urban district, in a balikota in an urban district, is elected directly from the population, rather than being indirectly selected from the local legislature. Okay, these are novel. So these are again, they're elections, the procedures, but these really were the big change for Indonesia. And these procedural changes are when I start to, I like to think of Indonesia as not having democratized, but become a consolidated democracy. And the general rules for Indonesian party competition and political operation have not changed in substantial ways since 2005. There have been a couple of important laws that have sort of discouraged forming new parties, and there's been some debate about whether or not district head elections are going to continue, but the general outline of Indonesian politics had been set in 2005. And so if we look at the trends in political liberties, political rights and civil liberties in Indonesia, this is just data from Freedom House, comparing the late Suharto era to today, we see very clear that the big change happens in 1999. So this implementation of competitive elections changes Indonesia from a place which is by global standards not free to a place which is by global standards quite free. Note that this does not change civil liberties in and of itself. So the distinction for a political scientist is the ways in which one participates in politics in terms of elections. These are political rights. In the terms of the rights that one has to live one's private life in the way that he or she chooses, those are civil liberties. Those did not change substantially in 1999, but they're bolstered by the presence of political rights. And again, you see here in 2005, after 2005, Freedom House promotes Indonesia to a fully free country, a status which remains the case until 2013, and I'll talk about that in a second. I also want to reflect on GDP and sort of economic output over this period. Now, of course, Indonesia's best economist here can tell us a lot more about what we ought to conclude about this, but the data are very clear of a couple points. So what I've done here is I've ranked all countries in the world by their GDP and their GDP per capita, so their economic output and their sort of economic output projected for population size, between 1960 and 2012. And what you'll see here is that under Suharto, under the New Order period, so this is the beginning of the New Order, this is the end of the New Order, Indonesia saw dramatic rises in its ranking of GDP. So it's not just the case that Indonesia grew relative to all other countries in the world as well. And it's important to note that that ends in 1999 and has continued in a stable trend here. And this is important for a couple reasons. One, it puts into context the differences in the ways in which policymaking policy is made and the way it's understood before and after the end of the New Order. And also, it highlights the fact that some of the fears about that Indonesia could not be democratic are not founded. Right. So the one you might look at this graph and say, well, look, Indonesia is no longer advancing in the ranking of world of countries around the world in terms of economic output, and that's right. But you could also look at that and say, well, it hasn't declined either, which was the fear at the time. So those are sort of descriptive things. So now I'll say things that are a little bit more interesting, perhaps, for this audience. And for those who are Indonesianists, you can start paying attention. There's three trends at the national level that I think are really important to keep in mind. The one is the erosion of programmatic brands for parties. By programmatic, I mean that a party or a party system features parties that have distinct policy platforms that can be arrayed against one another in ways that are distinct from one another. So it is not simply that one stands for something, that a party has a platform that it stands for, but also that platform can be distinguished in meaningful ways across many dimensions from others as well. Now this erosion has continued in Indonesia's democratic era. It is not the case that all parties are the same. That's not my point. It is the case that most programmatic statements are general and do not distinguish one party from another one. I think it's also important to note that this is a trend that started not just in the New Order, it started before the New Order. So this begins in 1957 with direct attempts by Indonesia's then President Sukarno to erode the sort of free fight politics that had been characteristic of Indonesia prior to that point. So the notion that parties competing in a free and open way on programmatic labels is somehow problematic has been a general problem in Indonesian politics for over half a century, but we have seen the continued erosion of these programmatic brands. The second is that these changes in the ways in which presidents and district heads are elected have led to a disruption of what we might call cross-level vertical accountability. Vertical accountability means the ability of voters through their delegates, through their representatives, their elected officials to police the sort of hierarchy of Indonesian politics or of any country's politics. That's what we call vertical accountability. It is the case that that Indonesian elected officials are accountable to voters, but within the elected official, the levels of elected officials, there is very little cross-level accountability. So it's very difficult for a president to hold a co-partisan district head accountable for anything. So the fact that they're elected from in two separate elections, from two separate voter bases, and two separate coalitions with two separate ideologies of rule means that the cross-level vertical accountability isn't right there. And you might contrast this to a system like the United States in which governors pay the price for being allied or not allied with Obama. And the third consequence of this is the personalization of politics. I think this is a sort of a counterpart of one. So it's not just the case that programmatic parties or the programmatic brands are becoming harder to discern or their parties are becoming indistinguishable from one another, but it's also the case that this isn't just degenerating into a kind of partisan clientelism, but it's also allowing for the emergence of individuals themselves. And again, we're going to hear a little bit about this later on. Individuals themselves play a particularly important role in elections, both local and national. And I think that what's neat about this, for those of you who have more comparative insights, is that a lot of these ideas had been anticipated in an important paper by Scott Mainwaring, published in 1993, on what happens when presidential democracies coexist with multi-party, which means not two-party electoral systems. When he wrote this article, he was thinking about multi-partyism as being a threat to presidential democracies in the sense that they would decline, or they would be overthrown in some fashion, that they would become vulnerable to being ousted. And that's not what has happened, but the mechanisms through which this threat was supposed to be realized, legislative immobilism, the problem of maintaining coherent coalitions, those are exactly what he predicted. So I think that we have some nice evidence that the insights from comparative politics are at play here. So some implications for national politics. One, there's a strong impetus at the national level for grand coalitions in the legislature. And if you were ever concerned that that was not happening anymore, just look to it this week, when I don't think it's any more true that there is a coalition Mera Putin, so there is no longer red-white coalition. I don't know what the new name for this grand coalition of all the parties except for Provost Party is, but that is now the coalition. So the impetus is to have grand coalitions, oversized coalitions, which include not just a center, because remember, there is no programmatic center in Indonesian politics, but rather just all of the big parties and all the small ones as well. Okay, so this is an impetus for grand coalitions, and you can see how this sort of reinforces the problems that I've addressed before. If all parties are seeking to enter coalitions, then the incentive to have a programmatic plan, which would incentivize yourself to not enter into that coalition, becomes smaller as well. So these things sort of reinforce one another. It's a self-enforcing dynamic. The second is, with grand coalitions, with many different partisans, with many different parties in charge, in which the legislative coalition is separate from the coalition that elects the president, and in which no parties particularly stand for coherent things, it becomes very difficult to implement a costly reform or to undertake a complex task. So it is still true that most governance tasks in any country involve multiple stakeholders at multiple levels of government and have distributional implications. In a system in which all parties are nearly all parties are involved in the making of policy, the log roll becomes such that any individual party can stop the implementation of anything which is particularly costly, which means that it's hard to do things like get rid of the gasoline subsidy. Even when it's done, it's sort of subject to rollback, right? And so implementation of reforms that are costly or undertaking a complex task like having an industrial policy which does not generate into rent-seeking, but rather involves large-scale investments in human capital and coordinating across multiple sectors in an economy becomes just very hard to implement. This is hard to implement. These are things that are hard to implement in any country. They're particularly hard in Indonesia. The third thing that I would think, that I think this is important for us to keep in mind, and again, I'm going to look to Bill because I'll think we'll talk about this, is that structure is really important for understanding why things don't get done in Indonesia right now. So all the things I've talked about are structural things. And so what's left is agency to explain what does happen. And what this means is, and this is tied to the personalization of politics, this means that individuals at various levels of government are responsible for making some of the changes, and you may consider this an interesting thing, or you may consider it a very worrying thing. We would like our system to not be reliant on individuals making important decisions. The implications, just briefly, for local politics. With decentralization of this type, there's great variation. I put great in square quotes because it's great in the sense that it's large. It's also great in the sense that I don't think it's great in the sense that we prefer there to be such variation. There are many districts that are free to implement experimental policies to innovate in ways that their voters like. And there are also many districts, local governments, that are free to be recalcitrant and stagnate. Right? And so what the centralization does is not necessarily generate incentives for innovation and for policy competition, but rather opportunities for backward regions to remain backward regions and not backward regions to continue to experiment. This has also been the laboratory for the emergence of political outsiders, such as Joe Coey, the president himself. This is a nice thing. And so there is actually a route to power that does not go through the center anymore. So now I'm going to talk about the coherent, or the more provocative things in my final 5 minutes. So I have a couple things to watch. So things that are new that I think are important to watch. One is this problem of multi-level administration without multi-level partisanship. If you agree with me that most governance tasks that are important and consequential for Indonesians are multi-level governance problems, you cannot decide in Jakarta to educate all the people in Indonesia. You have to rely on provinces to administer, and then districts to administer, and then villages to actually make sure that the schools are functioning. We have multi-level administrative problems, which have become even more multi-level because of decentralization. We do not have multi-level partisanship. So this level of vertical accountability that holds different levels of government accountable for one another has eroded. So the things you would need to have democratic politics incentivize good multi-level administrative function are exactly what Indonesia does not have at the moment. The second, I think, at the local level is we see a growing market for clientelism. There are now good ethnographic studies coming out by political scientists and anthropologists about what actually happens when at the village level, when district head elections happen, and the answer is that people sell their votes. Now, they sell their votes to multiple parties, and so this may sort of wipe itself out in the aggregate. This may not have any consequences for policy, but there is a market for clientelism. And I read a recent article, which may have been written by one of you, about in Java at least, there is a distinct language, a marketing language, using English words for what people do when they're buying votes. And so they talk about the vote price using English words for talking about how much they need to do. The third thing is regional divergence. And so this is a consequence of what I mentioned before. I won't talk too much about this. And so I believe that what we're seeing is there are certain parts of Indonesia which are becoming just remarkably prosperous, right? And this is and this doesn't show up in the aggregate because this is being masked by places that are becoming remarkably not prosperous. And finally, I can talk about this in Q&A or discussion if you like. There's an opportunity for policy diffusion, which if this is happening is the thing that would stand in the way of the other things. Now, some other things to watch. And I'm gonna abuse my time and take an extra minute because I think this stuff is important. So there are some new old forces, old force, for to use an old language, that I think it's important for us to keep in mind right now. The first one I want to talk about is a renewed prickly nationalism that is apparent in Indonesia. Ed Espinal has written a very important new paper, which appears in a journal whose name I forget, but it appeared recently, so you can look it up, which talks about how, especially under the Jokowi administration, but also in recent years as well, there's a sense, for me as an outsider, that Indonesia has become much more, not nationalist, because it's distinctive how nationalist Indonesia has always been, but prickly in its nationalism. The idea that Indonesian nationalism is not just something which unites Indonesians but distinguishes them from perceived threats abroad is notable and distinctive. I do not think it follows naturally from all the things I just spoke about previously, but it's something to watch. Second on this, I detect, and I think others do too, a renewed sense of militarism in Indonesia. Militarism does not mean an impending military coup. It means precisely the opposite. It means a return to a Suharto-era idea that the Indonesian military legitimately and self-evidently can exercise a socio-political function, which was not the case, and so is not the case in a place like the United States, and was not so widely held in the early 2000s. It is true that the military never left politics in Indonesia, but it is also true that this militarism is more assertive than it used to be. The notion that there should be anybody spending any time in Bela Negara, to me, is quite worrying. A third is a new moralism in Indonesian political culture. And this shows up in many different ways. So Jokowi's notion of revolusi mental, sort of general comments about politik beradab. So these are ideas that locate the problem in Indonesian politics, not in structures, not in individuals, not in bad choices, but in some failure of Indonesian as a people to understand what they're capable of. I'd love to talk more about this. I think it's really remarkable how widely this is shared. And finally, the fourth difference is what I would call the golonganization of difference. So golongan is the notion that Indonesians can be discreetly categorized into unique, non-overlapping sets of identities. And so this is the original etymology of golongan-karya, which is Golkar. And I think you can detect in Indonesia right now a sense that the sort of the liberal democratic ideal that people have many overlapping contested identities, and so one can be both a worker and a Muslim and a liberal at the same time. These things are becoming harder to sustain at one time, and so we have a re-golonganization, a re-discretization of potential identities that Indonesians have. The three words I haven't said, and it's important that I note them: Islam, civil war, terrorism. Why have I not said them? Because they don't matter that much. But I want to remark on the fact that I haven't said those, because in 1999, those were the three things that people would have worried about. And especially in 2003, after the bombings in Bali, these are things that people would have worried about. Our fears about the compatibility of Islam and democracy in Indonesia, we now know were misplaced. Our worries about the possibility that Indonesia could have a civil war, not just a secessionist war, but a civil war, they were misplaced. And our fears about the inability of the Indonesian government to handle terrorism have been misplaced as well. Our fears were misplaced. What am I missing today? I don't know. And with that, I will conclude by saying thanks. Thanks for your attention, and I look forward to talking more in the Q&A.
Okay. One of the advantages or disadvantages of going last is that most of the things I want to say have already been said, but I'll say them anyway. In fact, what I will say is actually completely consistent with what Dr. Basri has outlined in much greater detail, but I'm going to do it in a slightly different way. What I want to look at, my charge from Jay Rosengard has been to talk about the Indonesian experience in broad comparative perspective. And I'm going to look at it primarily in historical perspective and a little bit in international perspective. But to just continue on what both Dr. Basri and Professor Popinski said, how you describe the Indonesian economy depends on what you're comparing it with. And in this case, I just put the growth rates of Indonesia, of Latin America and the Caribbean and Sub-Saharan Africa, both per capita and overall GDP growth rates. And by that standard, Indonesia has done sensationally. This is from 1960 to 2013. Indonesia is far higher than either of those two major positions in the world. Where Indonesia falls short, which has also been pointed out, is when you compare it with Northeast Asia, with China, Korea, Taiwan, Japan, and so on. And I just put the countries, the periods in the various countries where they've grown at more than in red, that are more than 5% per capita per year. Indonesia only managed that for one decade, and that decade complicated. I won't get into the details, but it's been slower than that, but higher than the other. The second thing I want to make clear that, so I don't get misunderstood, I'm going to spend a fair amount of time saying what it is that happened during the Suharto years. And I'm going to be speaking quite favorably of what the 1980s and at least into the early 90s a bit, meant in terms of economic strategy. That does not mean, I think, that Indonesia should in any way go back, or that anybody in Indonesia wants to go back. it's possible that a country can have good economic policy and yet have the politics and repression and so on. The Pinochet government in Chile is a terrible government, but it actually did do some good things in economic sphere, which in fact the Chilean government had the sense when it got democracy, to continue. But let me, begin by saying, the first thing to note about the Indonesian experience, in my opinion, is that, it wasn't that Indonesia got independence and then all of a sudden took off. I first visited Indonesia, Jakarta and Bandung in 1962. That's one of the few advantages of being old. Quite frankly, the Indonesian economy, as I think many of you know, was a mess. When you measured things in Indonesia, they were all in the negative. The reels and rubber were going down, the inter-island shipping system was falling apart. The exchange rate was massively overvalued. In fact, when I had been writing my thesis in Hong Kong, and I was offered, a foreign exchange dealer in Hong Kong offered to finance, make an arrangement where I could pick up rupiah in Indonesia in my hotel room if I gave him a certain amount of money in Hong Kong. And I effectively could have spent the time in Indonesia for free because of that massive overextension. I decided I didn't really want to spend look at the inside of an Indonesian jail and decided not to do it. The only thing that was going up in that time was inflation, which was absolutely massive. So what changed? Well, other than the Sukarno government left and you got the military taking over in the form of President Suharto, to begin with, they brought in stability. They brought in macroeconomic stability. The second thing is that on the whole, and I don't want to overstate the case, but on the whole, they managed the natural resource problem fairly well. Now, I recognize that the president had friends who, the forestry sector is massively corrupt and so on and so forth. So I'm not overly naive about this. But the basic point is that particularly when you get into the 1970s and after the debt crisis of the mid-1970s when Indonesia went a little crazy on state enterprises and such things. But then we had a debt crisis back when it was easy to get out of a debt crisis as contrasted to the 1980s. But on the whole, the things they did in terms of the natural resource management, probably the most striking was the devaluation of the rupiah in 1978, where Ali Wardana, then the Minister of Finance, basically devalued the currency at a time when anybody normally would say, well, the balance of payment situation is great, the OPEC price increases have led large amounts of money to flow in, and therefore the currency should float in reflect the market. No, he wanted, and Professor Wajoya and the others in the technocratic group basically wanted to make sure that they could create the conditions for an effective industrialization program, because they recognized that industrialization was, as Dr. Basri has pointed out in his remarks, is an essential part of development at that stage. You cannot have sustained development solely based on natural resources. So the devaluation was the first step. They also recognized, the technocrats also recognized, that these high oil prices weren't going to last forever. And so they instituted a major tax reform that provided revenue, which actually came on stream kept macro stability in the mid-1980s when the price of petroleum and natural resources generally had fallen. But But then they had the problem of how do you get the incentives right for the individual entrepreneur in manufacturing? Indonesia was riddled with restrictions. My favorite example in this, of course, is the import situation, where I believe it was 70 different stamps had to be put on by importers in order to get a good into the country. Not only did that involve lots of bribes, but more important, involved enormous delays. And anybody who knows anything about the capacity to export manufacturers knows that you've got to be able to move faster than something that's going to involve you in weeks or months getting something out of the port into your plant. And so what Indonesia then introduced, what the technocrats basically introduced into Indonesia was a set of deregulation packages that effectively it was a battle between the technocrats and other parts of the cabinet to basically get rid of a lot of these barriers to entrepreneurship. And the result was a rapid rise in manufacturing. I'll show this one simple chart in a moment. Now, that wasn't all that they did. The issues of income distribution, despite the corruption, there were very important impress programs that were a fair amount of the oil money didn't all go to cronies. A lot of it did get down to the villages and did make a significant difference for the rural population and so on. But I'm not going to I'm focusing more on industrialization here. One key element of their strategy was that they did not go and look at Korea and Taiwan and Japan and say, well, this is the way Korea, Taiwan, and Japan did it, which is to say a highly government-led interventionist policy with lots of very specific interventions by the presidents and the prime ministers and by the Ministry of International Trade and Industry in Japan, and particularly in the Park Chung-hee era in the 70s in Korea. Where much of the design of the heavy industry program was done in the Blue House of Korea and so on. The technocrats in Indonesia recognized from early on that the capacity of the government, of their own ministries and of the government generally to manage that kind of a industrial policy was completely impossible. And, the basic problem was that Indonesia, as you probably know, but Indonesia really started with an enormous disadvantage in terms of its education level. And I've just put these are World Bank data from a much, much earlier World Bank. That's another advantage of being old. You have all your old copies of the World Bank report. And essentially, as you can see, the number of percent of the age cohort that was in secondary schools in Indonesia was only 6% in 1960. It had risen to 18%. But when you have that basic level, and if you go back to the 1930s, when the Dutch, 20s and 30s, when the Dutch finally introduced some primary education into Indonesia after doing essentially nothing prior to that. If there are a few brilliant people, Professor Wajoyo being one of them, who can sort of rise up in that kind of a system and do well. But generally speaking, you have to be a real genius to get ahead in that system when your parents are illiterate, the teachers are badly trained because they also have limited education and so on. And it takes generations before you can build a first class education system that can train your people in order to run a much more interventionist system. And so the basic approach of the technocrats was to basically rely on the market. The one thing I know Professor Wajoyo he'd stop listening to you if you suggested anything about For example, introducing capital controls. That was a no-no in his view, and the notion that you could do anything that elaborate was obviously out of the question. The money flowed freely, and all basically these people relied on the market. And what they got from it, and maybe I'll just go to the last slide, is they got that tremendous rise in the manufacturing exports. The blue line is the share of manufacturers in exports. The red line is the share of manufacturers in GDP. You went started from a very low level, and you got a sustained period of very rapid growth in manufacturing, pretty much like the rest of like the star performers of East Asia. That all, of course, falls apart in the latter part of the 90s, in the middle 90s and so on, when the greed of the Suharto family and their associates became so excessive that it undermined the quality of the financial system and so on, and led, of course, to the financial crisis and eventually the collapse of the regime. Indonesia then, of course, went through a period which, in retrospect, was actually pretty peaceful. I realize that anybody who was involved in it at the time didn't think it was very peaceful. In fact, the head of our project, Joe Stern, the HID project at the time, he and Sophia, his wife, were on either the last plane out and evacuated when they were evacuating foreigners or one of the last planes. And the reason, of course, the reason they couldn't get on the earlier planes was because the earlier planes wouldn't take Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan was their cat. Joe would be here today, except he's been very ill, so he is not able to be here. But basically, it was a fairly peaceful. It didn't take all that long, and I think an interesting example of why it worked was David Dappas was recently, just a couple weeks ago, along with Tommy Valley of our Vietnam and Myanmar programs. They took a group of Myanmar generals down to Bali, actually, to meet with a series of, and I hope you don't mind my telling you this, to meet with a series of with generals in Indonesia that had been involved in the transition period. And the interesting thing is what the generals said to the Indonesian generals said in their talks to the Myanmar generals is, the process is going to be messy, but don't intervene. If you don't intervene, things will smooth out and everything will be fine. And that, that's basically what we did. And hopefully the Myanmar generals will listen. But the point in this discussion is that gives you a good perspective on at least what some of the more progressive generals thought. So you made the transition. And then you've got what we've now heard at some length, but particularly from Dr. Basri, you've gotten the strategy of development of the last decade or longer, a little bit longer. And the problem with it, of course, is that basically the government is simply coasted, and it's coasted on high natural resource prices. And the result of that, Dr. Basri's gone into this in much greater detail, but this, I think, this tells the story. The exports of manufacturers as a share of total manufacturers have fallen sharply, and even as a share of GDP, when you're getting up toward 30%, you're getting up to sort of where you're beginning to think about moving on to services and manufacturing will slow down. But basically you've got premature, what is sometimes referred to as deindustrialization in Indonesia because of this reliance on high natural resource prices. And of course that has also now have brought the overall growth rate down a bit, although, again, if you're comparing with Africa or Latin America, it's done pretty well. So, you know, the basic point is that I think that China, I mean, I've spent too much of my life studying China, so Indonesia has to, has to somehow figure out how to get back to an effective manufacturing and industrialization story. And Professor Papinski and others have explained why that is going to be very difficult to do. And I have no idea how to do it. And so therefore, I will stop here and we'll open it up for questions. Thank you. The rules will be, we'll take questions, but you should state your name and affiliation before. So let's start.
Costly reforms are costly exactly because political processes are very complicated, very complex. And this is probably the mentioned that we need to institutionalize the reforms. So questions probably already can also respond how to institutionalize the reform in this complex political process.
So that's a great point. And I think that the general thrust of the suggestion has to be right. So if you wish to implement reforms and have them not be subject to rollback, you need to find a way to institutionalize them. But what does that mean? That means you wish to find some way to make the accountability mechanism work less good for things that you think are good. So less well for the things that you think are good. So the challenge with this is that institutionalizing a system to prevent rollback of reforms means finding some way to, it's a tricky problem that goes back to Madison in the US. How do you create a system that allows reforms that are sort of mutually beneficial to be made without then having that system also be able to channel the opposition to that reform as well? I think that we have some evidence of places where this works. I think that sort of at the macro planning level, Indonesia does very well. I think the reason why that is because the nature of the complex and highly technical tasks is such that with some very few exceptions, it's actually hard to know what are the distributional implications or the distributional costs of particular reforms. And so when BI sets a policy rate, it's not clear that anybody knows exactly if that they need to stop that or get in the way there. We unfortunately do have instances where this does happen. So we had this during the height of the crisis. We do know that this sometimes happens when the costs are acute. But I think this is not a uniquely Indonesian problem. But I do think that in a system where imagine a parliamentary system in which the prime minister is elected from the parliament, can call a no confidence motion, and has one or two parties in his or her coalition that delegates to a cabinet the ability to do complex tasks. Like that's the type of system which I think would be nimble enough to make these types of things. And then the only cost there is every new election you have the potential for rollback.
If I may add for this. I think this what Acho said is very important, Tom, about this how the institutionalize, because in the reality it's very difficult to sort of like to implement reform. So let me give an example about several things that we are able to continue the reform because we institutionalize it. The first one is we pass law on the maximum budget deficit. It's 3%. So the beauty of being Minister of Finance is you said that, I would love to accommodate the political pressure, but the law says that the maximum budget deficit is 3%. So this really ensured that the macro stability is there. The second one, let me share you this story. In 2013, after we adjusted the fuel price, there was a debate how to curb inflation. And one of our proposals at the time is to remove the quota on meat. because the meat price went up more than 100,000. It was, of course, this is very sensitive, but eventually agree, and then we use that price as an anchor. So if the meat price higher than, I forgot, 75, 76, you know, thousand, then, you know, we impose the tariff quota. And that's being institutionalized. I believe that later on Mary could also, you know, tell her story, because she institutionalized about the rice price, for automatic adjustment. And also the last but not least, also very important, is fuel price. Our proposal is to adopt the fixed subsidy, 1,000 rupiah per liter, so it will follow, so we doesn't need to come to the parliament, we doesn't need to be discussed in the cabinet meeting, automatically, you know, will follow. And if this happens, this will make the process of the reform become much easier. In our case now, Jokowi removed the fuel subsidy, but now the subsidy is back, because we don't institutionalize this on this sort of like a regulation.
Thank you. I'm Erin from the Bank Indonesia of New York. We have a small office there. Question to, it's really grateful to have such a distinguished speakers here. So let's make long-term outlook of the Indonesian economy. Dr. Basri mentioned earlier that basically we just follow the boom-bust cycle, right? So then the issue of the managing economic Indonesia is just concentrating on the stability of the macroeconomy. But then when you have to go further into this structural reform, it will be difficult. And then Tom, you said about the difficulties in the current situation where democratization and decentralization, which is come at the same time, make it really, really difficult to go to that direction. So based on that notion, and then you have to make a long-term outlook to the Indonesian economy. So probably this boom and bust cycle, as Dr. Basri mentioned, because of this democratization and decentralization, which is very difficult for us to go to the structural reform. Is that so? Thank you.
So I think that that's a sort of sobering question. So is the long-term outlook, your question I hear is the long-term outlook essentially to follow the boom and bust cycles of commodity prices, or is there a chance within the current system to change things? And I want to delegate to the economists here, like, the actual authority to make predictions. But one thing I will say is, of growth politics or growth rates. But I get the sense. My sense is that Indonesia is not resource wealthy enough for this to be a sustainable strategy over a century. So Indonesia has large amounts of valuable natural resources, but it does not have unlimited amounts of them, and they are not super easy to get. And the ones that it has are very, very geographically concentrated. So I think that there's a possibility for continuing along boom bust cycles, but eventually, I think that it has to. The incentives are there to create some sort of alternative, more sort of broad based foundation for development. But that's just my initial thought.
Dr. Basri, do you want to try that?
I think I'm more optimistic in the sense that I believe the resource boom is over, which is good for Indonesia. In the sense that now is a lot of incentive for the investor to look at the manufacturing sector again, because the reverse effect of the Dutch disease, the profitability of manufacturing will improve. The other one is look at on the policy in the last 4 months. All of a sudden, the government changed extremely about the first 6 months of the policy, for being restrictive, inward-looking, protectionist. All of a sudden, we mentioned that our intention to join TPP, we open up, you know, foreign direct investment. We basically, you know, move to the other way around, that we would like to attract the foreign direct investment to come. Why is that? Because the economy is slowing down. So I always believe, you know, when we had a very difficult situation, every president become a normal president. And every country become a normal country because they will bind by the economic, the real economic problem. So looking at the, you know, the boom bust cycle, I believe the commodity boom is over. And then, you know, we cannot rely so much on the, probably on the cheap labor anymore, because we have to compete with, you know, with the Bangladesh. So somehow it will drive our reform into that direction. But of course, the question is, how can we institutionalize this process? Because otherwise, once the economic situations become improve again, then the politician will say, we don't want to spend our political capital to continuation for the reform.
I'll maybe make a brief remark along those same lines. I remember a conversation in the mid-1980s, forgotten whether it was with Professor Bajoy or Ali Wadana, but where he basically said, this is really a good time because the, you know, things aren't so good that people can coast on it, but the but there are enough resources so we can do something. So they're sort of okay, but not great. You know, the exchange rate come down, and that made it much easier to do some of the things. Now that was in the authoritarian years. So the question then, the one thing I think that is positive about the current situation, to the extent that I understand it, is that everybody knows what needs to be done. I mean, all the, at least the people that are involved in this. You've got to do a lot about infrastructure, you've got to do something about the exchange rate, and so on and so forth. And you know, it seems like eventually it's conceivable one could get a political consensus. Now, I speak as an American, where we have, of course, a brilliant political consensus in the United States. But I'll leave it at that.
It's all right.
Gus, do you?
Gus Papanek, formerly of Harvard. I'm puzzled that you did not mention at all the effect of the democracy breaking out on minimum wage policy. Indonesia was very successful in exporting manufactured goods where you could mercilessly exploit labor. That is no longer so possible. And the political process results in competition for who can raise minimum wages the most. And that has been a factor, I think, in Indonesia's failure to be able to compete just as much as macroeconomic policy. But you didn't mention it, and I'm puzzled why. The second question I have is, I think you, can you hear me?
Yeah.
The mic distorts the voice.
Recording.
Oh, okay. The fact that if you put emphasis on the need to improve human capital, you are telling the political leadership that there's nothing they can do that will benefit them in the next election, because to improve human capital is going to take more than the term of the current president. Given the way the Indonesian educational system is set up. So are you really saying, this is a council of despair, or are you, when you press, saying that if macroeconomic policies were correct, there could be a very rapid response in the Indonesian economy, which is what I happen to believe. I have a question for Dr. Kavinsky. Yes, economic reforms are difficult for a variety of reasons, but if you don't carry them out, you will not perform, and politicians do like to get reelected. So aren't there some benefits from from carrying out reforms as long as they take effect and give you some benefits before the next election, so that you can do what the current president has done, which is leverage his performance in a variety of previous positions to become president.
Okay, let's, Dr. Basri.
Well, listening from your questions, then I'm pretty sure you are an advisor to many presidents, because exactly your question is typical of this, you know, the policymakers' question. The first one is on the issue of this minimum wage. I completely agree with you. I'm glad that you raised this issue. But we do have a problem here. And to be honest with you, I was trying to handle this issue, but not to avail very much. We do have the problem what we economists call the principal agent problem, because the agent, which is the local government, disobey the principal. We give the money to local government, but we cannot control them because the penalty is not there. Under Suharto, if in the local government they disagree, they can put them in the prison. So the penalty was clear, you get promoted. So once the penalty, the reward and penalty is clear, then there is no issue of this, you know, the principal agent problem. But related with Indonesia, unfortunately, decision regarding this minimum wage, it's made by the local government. Even the, probably, unfortunately, the highest increase of the minimum wage in Indonesia was in Jakarta. It was when Jokowi was a governor. It was back 2014, if I'm not mistaken. Now Jakarta are facing a problem because industry shift into Jawa Barat, to Western West Java, and also Central Java. So perhaps the solution to this is we should let this competition among the local government to attract the foreign investment to come, because we cannot really control the central government towards this. On your second question, I completely, you know, aware that sending people to go for studies, it takes one generation. But there is one shortcut to handle this issue, to attract foreign direct investment to come, because their technologies spill over. Look at the case of the auto industry. When the Japanese come, in the 70s, we completely import the CBU, the completely built-up car. Now, we can export a car to Japan. Why? Because the R&D is putting in Indonesia. So the FDI would be the relatively short solution in handle the issue of this improving the human capital. That is why the FDI is a very important one, but it's supposed to be focused on the export-oriented sector.
Okay, you want to say that?
Sure. So I think the thrust of your question is right, that it doesn't repeated elections give policymakers and politicians an incentive to perform in order to be reelected. I think that's right. I think that's the greatest argument in favor of democracy. So I agree with this. I believe that for many reasons, that accountability link is hard to sustain broadly and repeatedly across elections and across levels of government in Indonesia at the current moment. I'll give you the example from a PhD student who just defended his dissertation at Cornell named Diogo Posati. He wrote about Jamkesda, so these local health insurance programs, which are a remarkable example of things that voters want, that they ask their politicians to provide, and politicians provide them. So these are local health insurance schemes that protect people who are not covered by formal health insurance, things that come from being a government employer or something similar. What they do is they implement them, and then they spend money on them, and they run out of money around July. So if you get sick in August, there's no money to pay for your illness, right? So your health insurance scheme is no longer there. So the incentive is there to make a policy which is feasible, but in the implementation stage, it's often very difficult. So the argument is not, so you should not misunderstand me as saying democracy needs to be rolled back or that these incentives aren't there, but simply to just observe the many ways in which it falls short of the ideals that I think that many of us have.
David? Just a quick follow-up question to the group. Oh, David Cole, also in the past at Harvard, and a lot of time in Indonesia. You mentioned that there's been a major shift in the current government's policies from restrictive to open. that happened in the first year of this administration, and I think, and what led to that? What drove that? How did that come about? That's a pretty dramatic shift, and I think it's responsive to the questions that have just been asked about how do you bring about change in this political environment.
I think the answer is quite straightforward, because everyone was so panicked that the economic growth slowed down to 4.7%, and the unemployment increased, the poverty incidence increased. If the president wants to stay as a president in the next 5 years, he has to do something. Then he forgot about all this economic nationalism at the first place when he mentioned during the campaign. So he all of a sudden come up with this economic deregulation, open up with this foreign direct investment. If the economic growth continue to remain about 5.5%, 6%, I don't think, you know, this will happen. So again, it's proof the what we call the Sudley's law. The bad times makes good policy.
But that's a pretty quick response.
Because they see that there is an evidence that the poverty incidence increase it's never happened in the last 10 years. The unemployment increase. And 4.7% economic growth was slightly higher than during the global financial crisis. So SBY never had this kind of things. Of course, Jokowi doesn't want to be, you know, to be compared with, you know, SBY in the first years.
Okay, there are two questions here. Start. Wait for a moment.
Chung Xin Qing from FAS. I just want to ask, what's the current situation of government official corruption in Indonesia? Is the government corruption? And is any government policy to prevent this corruption?
Indonesian government is against corruption. So there is widespread public dissatisfaction with the level of corruption in Indonesia, both at the national and the local level. I like to think about these, the difference between, what's currently happening right now is hard for us to know. The characteristic debate since democratization has been between the idea of delegating to an independent statutory authority the ability to prosecute corruption crimes, and the understanding that those who would be prosecuted by that statutory authority have an incentive to accuse that statutory authority of being corrupt itself. And so this is the challenge, is that you have to find somebody who's uncorruptible to watch the corrupt people, and the incentive of the corrupt people is to accuse the uncorrupt people of being corrupt themselves. This is a hard challenge. One thing that I think is noticeable and important for us to keep in mind is the massive difference between the nature of corruption in the democratic era versus the authoritarian era. There's a wonderful paper by Andre Schleifer and Robert Vishny about the industrial organization of corruption, which contrasts a hierarchical model of corruption in which you have essentially a single peak bribe taker who monitors the sort of the performance of his or her subordinates in order to control the aggregate amount of corruption, but to extract as much as he personally can. And that's the Suharto model. With the current model, which is not so organized, it's not hierarchical in the same way, what this means is that the corruption is smaller in each transaction, but larger in aggregate, I think. And so the story that you used to hear is that, and I don't know if this is apocryphal or not, but I think enough people have said this that this sounds right, is that under Suharto, you knew exactly who to bribe and how much to bribe, because it was like 10%. And you knew, importantly, once you paid that bribe, that was the last bribe you were going to pay. So you could know with certainty that the bribe was the last one. Whereas now, you don't know at any transaction how much is the bribe, how much are you going to have to pay, and if you pay it, there's no ability for someone down the line to say, well, I need another bribe. You can't say, well, I already paid that one. So that's the sort of the difference here. I think I don't think we've seen massive progress in reducing the overall level of corruption. And one of the Jokowi administration's promises, which I think is effective, is to just take the ability of public officials to extract bribes away from them by procedures such as e-budgeting and e-governance, things that sort of make it impossible to exact this sort of discretion on its own.
I would only qualify that as when you get to the latter part of the 1990s, going up toward the financial crisis, there was no way that it was controlled. And it was totally out of control. And foreign direct investors and all kinds of people were being ripped off in ways that were completely unpredictable. But let me go on.
Thank you. David Merrill, U.S. Indonesia Society, USINDO. My question is for Dr. Vastri, and it's also on the subject of human resource development. Dr. Vastri, as we have discussed once or twice, you gave your strong support to the establishment at the ministry of a $1 billion scholarship fund for Indonesians to do their graduate study overseas. It's a tremendously significant initiative for Indonesia's economic development, potentially perhaps some of the recipients may be in the room today. How do you feel that program is going? And what do you feel needs to be done to make sure the U.S. gets a fair share, which has not been happening for some reason that we're trying to get at?
I think the amount of money that the government allocated, when I was there, about 16 trillion, now it's probably about more than 20 trillion. So we invested in the government bonds. 8% per annum. So every year, the money is available about 1.6 trillion for scholarship for any Indonesian get accepted in the top 200 universities. The problem is, unfortunately, when I was there, we were only able to send 3,000 students for 3 years. Why? Because it's very difficult for many Indonesians to get accepted in the top 200 universities in the world. So the problem is more on the supply side rather than the demand side. They could get accepted in the, I don't know how many, all the Indonesian students at Harvard, perhaps maximum 12, or all the, I don't know how many in MIT. So the issue is always about the issue about the supply side. But one thing that we go extend further, I'm glad to hear that, now we use this money as well. If researchers get published in the top tier journal, they will get a research grant. So using this, again, 100 or 200 top-tier journals. So that kind of things perhaps will improve the quality of human capital. But again, we probably need to be patient for this because the critical mass is simply not there, Ambassador Merrill. And then the other thing is, once, you know, the other problem related to the issue of this human capital, the original idea, but it was rejected definitely, on the cabinet. Our idea at that time is we don't ask the student to return to Indonesia because my idea at that time is India, Bangalore will never exist without Silicon Valley. So if Indonesians go overseas, then they will make their own network later on. But of course, this idea is just too crazy at the time because, you know, you spend the money and you haven't got any return. But later on, I believe that probably we should send more students to get a sort of like network in the future. I don't know. Hopefully, it could be done in the future.
We have time, I think, for one more question. Yes. Up at the top there.
My name is Aki from Wesleyan University. My question is for Professor Papinski. I'm curious about this militarism that you mentioned earlier, and there was an article recently from the Jakarta Post about popular demand actually supporting the return of militarism in the public life and in education as well. My question is, what can explain this return of militarism in Indonesia? What's the origin, and how is it related to the creeping or always existing sentiment, anti-communist sentiment in Indonesia. Also, my question for Professor Perkins, you mentioned about Myanmar, and my understanding is that the military transition in Myanmar has been largely modeled after the military transition or political transition in Indonesia. What can we tell about the future of democracy in Myanmar given this rising militarism in Indonesia? Thank you.
That's an important question that you've asked, and it's important that someone sort of your age is asking it. Because this is you're the generation for whom this is, I think, most significant, and you're the generation that is, you know, has the ability to police it, if you like. As to where it comes from, I don't know. I believe, however, that this is not a sort of latent mass demand for more military involvement or a more prominent role for the military in public life. I believe that it is a consequence of an institution which has never been removed from public life, but has not chosen to act upon its abilities and institutional purposes. So I think that this is largely my instinct, my intuition is that this is a top-down phenomenon, and it's one that I don't believe the Jakarta Post story that this is a bottom-up sort of natural sentiment. I do believe, however, that things like nationalism are bottom-up. I think that there are some values and some views that have been so thoroughly communicated to Indonesians that they are legitimately held. And so the idea that one is an Indonesian, even though one is also Batak or one is also Javanese, I think is naturally, widely, and unquestioningly held, and that's a remarkable thing. The idea that we ought to ensure that there's a local military commander making sure that all the kindergartners know what Pancasila means, I don't think that is a natural feature of Indonesian society.
There are probably others in the room better qualified than I to answer your question, but in both countries, you had one of the principal organized parts of the society was the military. In one, the military retained a substantial degree of popularity in such that that is Indonesia, where in fact, despite the Suharto years, the presidents elected are major candidates were military figures, not all of them obviously, but or the current. But in Myanmar, you had a very well organized alternative political party, the NLD, the National League for Democracy, and the long incarceration of Aung San Suu Kyi as the leader of that, and so on, that just I think fundamentally changed the politics of it in terms of what would happen in an election, and the overwhelming whether it won something like I don't know what the percentage, but it. Huge percentage of the vote you didn't have. So it was a fairly different kind of situation. But beyond that, I think I can't draw any real conclusions. We have run out of time. In fact, we ran over time, but we started behind time. So we will stop here. And there's, I think, a break in the schedule for a couple minutes. And who would like, well, Jay has left us, so Trish, do you, or Trish, Tony, do you want to be authority here?
Well, this is a 15-minute
break. 15-minute break, okay.
Yeah. The break will be in our window outside, just right from this room.
Okay.